been released. So it's pretty hard to give you a comprehensive list. However, there are a couple of things that you should take away from this from this topic lecture or any other topic lecture you go and watch after camp. And that is two things. The first is that you have to know the potential advantages. One of the most important points of debate is that those who prepare the most and have the most specific answers to things will probably win a lot of debates. So one of the goals of this is that you know the potential advantages. I think that if you go to your first tournament and you do not have an answer to every advantage that was predicted at a camp, you have not even begun to prepare, because I guarantee you that people will think of a lot more things than what's on my list, and things that maybe we haven't even conceived of, because we have not researched the literature in depth yet at this point. So if you don't have answers to this, you haven't even done your starting point of the topic. So you have to know the potential advantages. The second point is that you have to know the potential affirmatives, and you should have a strategy for each of those affirmatives. I think I'm going to list in total something like nearly 30 affirmatives, distinct plan actions that are all distinct from each other, and that's just, this topic is much bigger than that even, but you have to have a strategy for each of those, and we're going to talk about what you're capable of doing against those strategies, but at a minimum, your generic strategy, you should have a specific link or argument to every one of the affirmatives that we talk about. That's just the beginnings of preparation for a topic. So these two things are kind of what I want you to keep in mind, that we're trying to understand the potential for what the topic is, so that before your first tournament, you're prepared for these things, because the things that I'm talking about are the most predictable things. There's less predictable things that probably will be done, and those you'll have to respond to as the season goes on. So if you haven't prepared for the most predictable things, you're never going to have time to then also prepare for all the unpredictable things that people do as the topic develops. So the resolution, Ryan talked about that last night. I'm not going to go over what the resolution says very much. Just to reiterate, is that the United States federal government should substantially increase its exploration and or development of space beyond the Earth's mesosphere. We're going to start first with a portion that of debate that's not really talked about very much. This is probably the only section of a lecture you'll get on this year, which is current space policies. This is also something known as inherency for those new to debate, which is just the idea that you can't implement a space policy the U.S. federal government already does. So before we can talk about the potential affirmatives, we have to talk about what the U.S. federal government does today, because you can't do those things. They're already being done. So the foundation of U.S. space policy is found in a document called the National Space Policy. That's a document that's released that outlines each president's vision of our space policy. It's been being released since President Reagan has had this name. Each president has released one. There's been different times in between how long they've been released. Between Obama and Bush's space policy was relatively short, because I think it was only like 5 or 6 years. But each president has one. There are obviously significant differences between President Obama's national space policy and President Bush's before him. The main differences between these two policies, we'll talk about a lot of these things, are that Obama's policy emphasizes international cooperation in space, which is a direct difference between his and the previous national space policy. One of the second differences is there's much more of an emphasis on the control and removal of space debris. The third emphasis that I'd say is mainly different is that President Bush's space policy emphasized a strong need to militarize or have U.S. Hard power and leadership in space, whereas Obama's space policy is open to the possibility of international arms control in space, which is kind of a 180 from President Bush's stance on that. There are a couple of program unconditionally. And so there is a conflict. What I'm about to show you is commitments Obama has made. Now, some of these things might never get implemented, might not actually have a policy. So I don't know if these necessarily preclude acts, but we will talk about what exists and what commitments are. There's a commitment to GPS satellites. This, I'd say, will probably get implemented. I think if you try to read like a GPS satellite's good affirmative, that we should send some GPS satellites up, that is probably not competitive. That's happening right now. There's a strong commitment to it in the National Space Policy. I don't think this is a potential affirmative, because there's a pretty good commitment to this in the status quo. GPS does do all kinds of great stuff, but we don't need to talk about that, because that's something that we already do. There is a strong commitment to international cooperation. We can see that, talked about last night, that the U.S. works with Russia and the EU on the International Space Station, and technically Japan and Canada also built modules for that for us. There's plans to expand that cooperation into other areas. There's no specific policy proposal outlined in this section of the document, but there is a pretty broad commitment to this. What that might mean for the topic is that if people read a counterplan against you that says the U.S. should work or consult with the EU, you might argue that that's normal means, that the current way that the U.S. federal government implements space policy is to consult other countries and to work with them. So I think that this might implicate counterplan competition on the topic, but isn't a real policy. There's a commitment to maintaining radio frequency access and shared radio frequency standards internationally. This is probably not a very sexy part of space policy, but it is a big problem. There's limited frequencies by which radio and television can go out, and if you jam up that spectrum, you can't communicate to your satellites. Your satellites can't send information to Earth. It's a pretty big problem if you have radio frequency problems. There aren't current problems. It makes a commitment to continue doing things to help that. There's a commitment to assisting and using commercial operations in all U.S. space policy. There are two parts of this commitment. The assisting part says in the policy that we should try and do things that help commercial space ventures do well in whatever their goals are. The second part is that in anything that NASA chooses to do, we should use private contractors as much as possible. Again, I think this implicates counterplans on the topic, which is another lecture that will be discussed. But I think that in the status quo, we have a strong commitment to doing these things, no matter what space policy you're pursuing. And I think that makes it problematic. A counterplan says the United States federal government should fund some private industries. That's probably the same thing as the plan. Any plan that goes into outer space is going to use private industries. There's a commitment to send a person to an asteroid. This is probably the most specific commitment. There's some question about if this will be funded. We don't really have rockets right now to send anyone anywhere, much less a delivery vehicle or a mission to go to an asteroid. So we have to spend billions of dollars to develop a rocket. No one's sure really what the rocket program is going to look like. It's unclear how this is going to happen. This is going to also require a big congressional commitment. President Obama cannot send people to an asteroid by himself. And I think the plan is to land someone on an asteroid by about 2020. It's not a very strong commitment. That commitment might also involve landing someone back on the moon. But the document says we don't really care if they do or not or don't. We might land someone on the moon if it's helpful to the goal of landing someone on an asteroid. There's a commitment to support the ISS, which is the International Space Station. That's short. And until 2020. It's about to be finished being built. There will be about 8 years where it's fully operational until it is decommissioned. That lifetime will be about a third of its lifetime, because ISS has been up there for about 20 years since the first component was put in space. So it still has about a third of its life left. One note about this, a lot of people say that we can extend ISS's lifetime far beyond this. There's been some good science that's been done there, and there might be some people who advocate converting the ISS into a This is for sure an affirmative, expanding this, and we'll talk about that a little bit later, but there is a commitment until 2020, but affirmatives might add to it, which there are no plans to add to it right now. Affirmatives might extend that deadline of support out beyond 2020 and things like that. There's a commitment to develop new launch technology. This goes along with number five. This is just a commitment. We don't have rockets to go into space, and this is just a commitment that says that America probably needs some rockets that can send people into space. We do have some rockets that can send satellites into space, but not people. That's the key difference there. There's a commitment to developing climate satellites. These are both climate and weather satellites. We'll talk about this. This is a commitment, but like the NOAA's funding for its new weather satellites was just cut by Congress. This is a big example of something that's in the NSP that I don't think is going to be supported by Congress. Congress has already made cuts to this program. It's open to the possibility of space arms control. There's no outline for which treaties we'd be willing to sign, what that treaty would be look like, and we're going to talk about that in a second. But it says we might do that. And there's a big commitment to reducing space debris. There's a huge portion of this document that's about space debris, all kinds of inane stuff about it. For instance, so you understand the magnitude of this particular problem, there are 19,000 decommissioned satellites, and there are large pieces of junk in space from where satellites have hit each other. It's estimated that there are 600,000 pieces of debris in space. Each one of those 600,000 pieces is capable of destroying anything that's in space, the International Space Station, other satellites, or anything else. The reason for this is because of the relative velocities of these things. Not going to give a physics lecture, but I will say so that you kind of understand why space debris is such a big problem. When you have two different things traveling in space relative to each other, there's like between 10,000 and 20,000 mile per hour difference in the rate that they're traveling. That's like about the rate that they collide at in relative velocities. And that's why even a screw can destroy an entire satellite. So it's a big problem. We don't really have a good way to remove stuff from space. There's also a theory called cascade effect, or Kessler syndrome, which a lot of people talk about if they read this as an advantage, which is the theory that once one, if a major satellite were to be taken out and become debris in satellite orbit, it would probably destroy most of the other satellites because it would put a lot more debris. Because even though there's a lot of debris, we know some of where the debris is. We try to move decommissioned satellites into other parts of orbit so that they don't mess with satellites that are in the functioning orbits. But if one of the satellites in a functioning orbit were to get destroyed, it might have some pretty bad effects. Could possibly make it so that we couldn't launch things into space anymore until we clear up all the debris, so completely stop space traffic. This is Ryan's favorite dissad, that sending things up into space is going to stop all space exploration. So I'm sure he'll be talking about that a little bit more. So there is a couple other areas of space policy I want to get through pretty quickly, which is that there's also some international space policy. You should know something's going on in the status quo there. The Outer Space Treaty is the main piece of international law. It was ratified in 1968. Its full name is called the Treaty on Principles Governing the Activities of States in the Exploration and Use of Outer Space. Currently, this mostly governs the people that launch stuff into space, which is the U.S., Russia, Japan, China, the EU, India, Israel, and Iran. Those are the only people right now capable of launching things into space, or that have done so. And so some things that it outlines that are probably important. It says that outer space, including the moon, is not subject to national appropriation. It means that no nation can claim those for themselves. There's some question about if this means that whether or not you can mine resources in space. That's an important part of the topic because there's some question about whether or not you can take property back to Earth and not claim it for a single nation. Right now, you're not allowed to claim property in space for a single nation. So there's some legal ambiguity on that question. It prohibits the placing of nuclear weapons in space or other weapons of mass destruction. It also prohibits the testing of military weapons in space, including anti-satellite weapons. This means that most affirmatives that do all of those things, any type of military thing, probably violate the Outer Space Treaty. It also opens all stations and equipment in space to international inspection by other states. So technically, anything in space can be boarded and inspected by members of other nations. You can't stop that. That's international law. I don't really know how you stop anyone anyway once they're up there. Fourth thing is that states are required to seek international consultation in the event that any action they take could harm the use of space. So it's a pretty broad commitment. It outlines a lot of things that we're supposed to be doing. For instance, that last consultation thing, again, means that these kind of counterplans are probably a little bit problematic, because international law says we have to consult with people anyway before we do stuff in space. Second piece of international space policy, the EU Draft Code of Conduct. This is, it's draft, it's not a treaty, it's not binding to any of its signatories. But the U.S. did help create a lot of these rules. There's also, we had input because in response to China's testing of anti-satellite weaponry, which we'll talk about a little bit more what that is. It's not really binding right now. It calls for a lot of things we've already talked about in the U.S. National Space Policy, because the U.S. National Space Policy under Obama was modeled after this document. So a lot of the things that he outlines, those commitments we already talked about, are commitments to this document. But right now, it's not ratified or anything like that. You've already heard what most of those commitments are. Commitments to space degrees, international cooperation, stuff like that. The last is the Treaty of the Prevention of the Placement of Weapons in Outer Space. Now, this is an unratified treaty that the U.S. opposes completely. But it is important because Russia and China did draft this treaty and submitted it to the United Nations. It calls for a couple of things. Prohibits any weapons in space, not just nuclear weapons or weapons of mass destruction, but any weapon at all. It obligates members not to use weapons or threaten to use them in outer space against other space assets, so you can't destroy satellites or other things. And it's binding on the signatories. It's not just like a suggestion. Yeah, I'm not really sure how this could possibly be an affirmative. This might be a counterplan that people read against militarization affirmatives, that we should maybe ratify this treaty. And because if some of the advantages of those affirmatives are that we need to blow up China, this is the obvious alternative, that we need to cooperate with China. This is China and Russia's treaty. So, you know, if you want to have a true debate about the opposite ends of the spectrum, where the affirmative says we need to blow up China and Russia, the negative might say maybe we should ratify this treaty and be friends with them. It's possible use, I think, in terms of the topic. So, this other stuff I'm going to go through pretty quickly, because we covered this, Ryan covered a lot of this last night. Potential actors, NASA, that's any civilian space program, any non-military space program, they probably do. If you're sending people anywhere, they probably do it. That's probably their purview. A lot of exploration, they would probably do. Mining, they would probably oversee that. Kind of like the FAA oversees all commercial air flight in the U.S. NASA would probably oversee commercial ventures in space. We're not really sure, there's not that many, but they do now. Ryan talked about their budget last night. The Department of Defense, whose budget for space is bigger than NASA, I think that's pretty important to note. Their budget for space, you saw last night that NASA's budget is $18 billion. Their budget for space is something like $22.4 billion. No one really knows. Because all their space operations are mostly classified. Mostly the U.S. Air Force does them. In military terms, only the U.S. Air Force is allowed to operate assets in space. So they're probably the subset of the some people, my friends over at the Naval Academy, would certainly read an affirmative that says we should put the Navy up into space. And there's actually literature, there's a lot of people who get graduate degrees from the Naval War College, the Army War College, and those of them that are interested in space probably say we should take space away from the Air Force. There's all kinds of theses. You should look at those two, the military postgraduate schools, if you want to read that affirmative. That's a potential affirmative on the topic. There's a couple things they do. They provide surveillance and radar data. They provide secure military communications to anywhere in the world from space, which is important to almost all of our military operations. They provide missile warnings through NORAD, which its Earth headquarters is in Colorado Springs, Colorado. But that requires lots of space assets, so we know when missiles might be incoming. They provide space situational awareness, which is the fancy military term for tracking space debris and trying to keep it out of our important assets. They also have historically overseen the global positioning satellites. Those were launched by the Department of Defense. There are some military launch vehicles that are identical to commercial ones. There's some that the Air Force has uniquely developed. And most of the defense activities are surveillance in nature. To our knowledge, there's not really offensive capabilities in space. Again, a lot of this is really questionable what all they're doing up there right now. Now, the Department of Commerce, now Ryan talked to you about this last night. He talked to you about the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Association. That's not technically a cabinet-level branch of the executive, which means that it doesn't have, like, a secretary position in the cabinet. NOAA reports to the Secretary of Commerce, which is why they have space purview. No one is really sure why the NOAA is in the Department of Commerce right now. It's like kind of an oddball. A lot of people, I don't know if you remember, Obama gave a pretty famous speech earlier this year where he talked about some things about how, for instance, salmon are controlled by four separate branches within his executive branch. And some of those things are partly, and some of those things that he talked about, the confusingness of the federal government is because things like this, that the NOAA is part of the Department of Commerce, even though their mission is entirely scientific and mostly about space, they are neither part of NASA nor, I don't even know, maybe the Department of Energy is the most scientific branch of the federal government. But they do a lot of stuff. They help oversee some of the commercial space ventures. They can also help send money to commercial space ventures because that's the promotion of commerce, which is their primary mission. The other things that they do, the NOAA has weather satellites. They monitor ocean and climatic shifts. And they also study space weather, which is actually pretty important because solar flares in space can knock out entire satellites. That's an app that we're going to talk about in a minute. This is totally wrong. Not the Department of the Treasury. It should be the Department of Energy. It's totally a mistype. Sorry about that. It's the Department of Energy. The Department of Energy does not do anything in space right now, but they have been given statutory authority over a potential future space activity, which is that any nuclear propulsion or nuclear weapons in space must be overseen by the Department of Energy because they oversee all nuclear stuff here on Earth. The Department of Energy approves all nuclear plants down here. They are the nuclear experts within the federal government. So the Department of Energy would be involved in any affirmative that does nuclear things. And that would, and potentially as an affirmative, if you did something nuclear, that would give the Department of Energy for the first time a space policy within that branch of government. So I think it's potential that if you think that these other departments stink at their operation in space, might run some advantages to the idea that the Department of Energy would be better comparatively than these other actors. Now you'd have to put nuclear assets in space to give them a space department, but you might argue that's good. So the advantages. The first thing I want to say before I talk about this first advantage is that by that is there are like 50 different ways to send a person to Mars, at least, that have been proposed that are credible in the literature, but proposed by at least one rocket scientist. And that's just Mars alone. There are 50 different proposals. I mean, there's a million different proposals for how we should try and colonize the moon. So there's going to be a lot of different ones. You know, you might, in one affirmative debate, you know, hit someone who only wants a temporary base on the moon. The next affirmative debate, someone who wants a permanent base on the moon. And those are like, they'll claim they're two separate affirmatives. The problem is that there's much less advantage diversity. The reasons for doing those things are not substantially different than each other. So one of the key approaches to this topic that you should think about is that it's all about the advantages, because you are definitely going to hear plan text that you never heard before all the time. So you want to approach the topic and have good answers to advantages, because it doesn't matter. Most of the benefits of going to space are limited. They're fairly predictable. So I think that's a much better approach strategically to the topic. What does this mean? That means you should prep against advantages. You should have good advantage counterplans. There's a file that's being worked on here for that. You should have disadvantages that specifically link to advantages. For example, maybe a disadvantage that links to trying to solve climate change, or maybe a disadvantage that links to specific advantage actions, because this will minimize the impact of new affirmatives and new affirmative mechanisms that people are going to read against you. Another general tip about these advantages is that the timeliness of advantages versus disadvantages is a big structural difference in the topic. Getting benefits from space can take a long time, and we'll talk about which of these things will probably take a long time. But destroying our economy today from spending is probably a lot more short term, because we have a lot of budgetary problems right now, and they've kind of been stewing for a long time. So there's a lot better timeliness for your disadvantages versus the advantage, which is one structural advantage for the negative on this year's topic. So the first advantage, U.S. hegemony. For those who are young at debate, hegemony is a term for the sort of sum total of a country's leadership in the world. It includes things like hard power, which is the fancy name for all sort of military power and sort of anything you can do to threaten another country. That kind of encompasses hard power. It also encompasses soft power, which is, you know, your ability to get other nations to cooperate with you. Soft power also, some people say, is your cultural ability to influence people. For instance, American movies, some people say, are part of our soft power. And so hegemony is just the sum total of the U.S.'s ability to, like, control and influence world politics. And a lot of people have said that it's very important to have a hegemon. A little historical example, you know, Rome kind of dominated the Mediterranean part of the globe during its rise to power. And a lot of people say that hegemony that it had helped create the stable conditions for a very thriving civilization for a few hundred years. A lot of people say that America is the current hegemon, which is why this is an important advantage, because a lot of people say that since the Cold War, there's no one really that matches the U.S. in global leadership. For instance, our military spending equals the entire rest of the globe's combined. We have military predominance, we have cultural predominance over most of the world, and a lot of people say that this has set up a lot of prosperous conditions over the last two decades. How these advantages are going to work is that a lot of them will probably be based off of military reasons, that the U.S. needs to improve its military or have better military capabilities. There's lots of reasons for this. One thing that space lets us do is it will probably let us use less humans in warfare. There's all kinds of proposals for these. Rods from God, which is a name, that's a specific name for a proposal, which is that because of the really fast speeds in space that we already talked about, you can put like a rebar pole up in space, and as long as you can there's a lot of literature. Historically, one of the important parts of hegemony in the last few hundred years has been controlling sea lanes. Sea lanes have been a big part of commerce. A lot of people think that space is kind of the next open oceans, where there needs to be someone who can control and keep it open, because we use space for all kinds of modern communications and technology. And so keeping space open for those and not hostile, for instance, if a country were to develop weapons from the ground that could shoot down satellites, they could like shut down a lot of global communication just by shooting those satellites as they come by. And so it's probably important that the U.S. maybe takes a leadership role in keeping space open and free, which is something that we do for the oceans all over the globe in the status quo. The U.S. has been called the global navy, because although there are other navies, the U.S. has the largest navy, and the U.S. makes a commitment to open up naval lanes all over the globe. That's why whenever Iran is kind of starting to do crazy stuff, there's an important sea lane that gets a lot of oil access in the Middle East to a lot of the globe. We'll send more naval ships there to help keep those sea lanes open and show our commitment to keeping those sea lanes open. That's something we've also done in parts of Asia and straits there whenever there's been geopolitical turmoil. There's two sort of other sub-advantages that go along with this that I want to talk about, which is space weaponization and space militarization. These are sort of subsets of the first thing. Space weaponization kind of involves having weapons in space that are primarily aimed at other space things. And that's kind of considered one category of space military ventures. The space militarization, a lot of people refer to more as military ventures in space that are designed to give us military dominance here on the Earth. There's different ways that these terms get used, but basically these advantages are that we should, put weapons and control space militarily, that'd be good. I think it's fairly straightforward how those advantages work, because the argument is that the U.S., can save more lives if we do this. A lot of these might say that other people are inevitably going to put weapons or military in space, so if we don't get there first and have the best weapons, those other countries will then be able to destroy us. So we need to get there first so that we have the best infrastructure. They're pretty straightforward. They are going to be a huge part of the topic, even though I haven't spent a ton of time discussing them. I think they're going to be a huge part of the topic, and the reason for that is that they answer a key question, because the United States federal government is obviously key to these things. Only the federal government has a military policy. There are private companies that don't have military policies. And the EU can't do our military policy for us. So there's built-in defenses of these things, which we'll talk about that in a second, too, the built-in defenses. Economic growth. In 2010, the global space economy was estimated at $276 billion, which is small in comparison to the global economy, but it has enormous rates of growth. That number is 50% bigger than it was 5 years before it, and it's expected to grow even more than that. It also has tremendous other benefits. For instance, GPS satellites and their maintenance are a part of that number, but the benefits to GPS, i.e. all of the GPS making companies, TomTom, Garmin, Magellan, there are multiple companies whose only business is pretty much making GPS receptors. So there's huge parts of the economy that are opened up through space development. For instance, memory foam is a pretty big industry that was invented by NASA. Domes here on Earth were invented using technology that NASA made. A lot of people say that most of the modern plastics industry was created by NASA. Computer miniaturization, which just involves all personal computers, was in large part a push by NASA because they had to make computers smaller to get them into space. And so even though they didn't do everything to bring the personal computer to you, they were an important part of the components necessary to do that. So sure that, you know, the recession doesn't get worse or another bigger recession comes back. The aerospace industry, this is kind of a subset of the economy advantage, which is why I have it here. This is just a specific part of economy-based arguments. Some of them will be that by doing this, the aerospace industry will benefit. It will be able to spin off these technologies. It will be able to use some of the new things in its airplane technology, which is big business. The other side of this point is that the aerospace industry is key to U.S. Military power and economic power because it's an important commercial venture. A lot of people argue that we need to have a strong aerospace industry as a fundamental part of any sort of modern economy. So giving the aerospace industry lots of jobs is good because then we'll make sure that we have a strong domestic aerospace industry. There's also some powerful lobbyists in this, so some people might read this to gain the political advantages from this. Space leadership is kind of something we've already talked about a little bit. I'll go into a little bit more depth. This is sort of a subset of U.S. and Germany, which we talked about at the top, but the U.S. is currently the world leader in all things related to space. There are some intangible benefits to that. It contributes to our prestige. It helped us demonstrate that democracy was better than communism by proving that the U.S. was more technologically advanced than the Soviet Union. Some people take that argument and run with it. They say that if our leadership in space declines, we will become a second-rate power, that none of our other prowess can be legitimate without being the best in space. For instance, China has made a big commitment to space. Some people say if they get more advanced than us in space, we can no longer be a better power than them. It also gives some actual benefits. It's the foundation of modern military power. The way the modern military works cannot work without U.S. space dominance. They provide targeting, communications, and are the reason we have to deploy military anywhere in the world. So there's a lot of benefits to that, which are subsets of U.S. leadership. STEM education, or education in general, which STEM is a fancy acronym for science, technology, engineering, and mathematics, basically most of the hard sciences and math. And these advantages, these were a big part of the college topic. If you go and look at any of the college cases from last year, there were like a million things that STEM education was important for. Virtually any industry in the world, any new industry, is going to require engineering. So good engineering education is key to the future of any, you can name it, alternative energy, future transportation ideas, future U.S. infrastructure, the ability to fight wars in the future. Engineering and science is all going to be a part of that. The last time we had a big space program commitment, there was a big commitment in addition to it to training scientists. So some people think that if we made a commitment to NASA, a big, bold, symbolic commitment, that would help invigorate people in STEM technology, would also help invigorate science and technologies departments within universities as they cooperate and help, you know, the space complex rev up and become bigger. There's a ton of different advantages to this, and I would definitely say that looking at last year's college topic will tell you a lot about that. Mining. There are a lot of projections of shortages of rare earth metals in the United States. Rare earth metals are like they sound. They're very rare here on the Earth. They're not so rare up in space. That's why they're rare earth metals, because we think they got here by asteroids colliding with the Earth. That's where we think these rare earth metals came from. So we can just go to the source and get them. In the status quo, 90% of all rare earth metals come from China. The reason for this is that there were some other rare earth mines, most notably one in Nevada that is being reopened right now. They were closed down because rare earth metals were worthless at the end of the 90s. They weren't worth any money. And China flooded the market and got us to close down our mines through some sort of anti-competitive practices. They dumped in the market and got us to close our mines. And then they had control of the world market, which is good for them. Then we our solar cells have to have rare earth minerals. We found out that these things are pretty useful as trace elements in alloys. We mixed these in with steel and stuff. We found out it can make the steel a lot better and stuff like that. So we learned that they have a lot of great properties, even though they're not the main component of almost any industrial thing. Most modern industrial processes require them. And so going out and mining space might help us. I'm not really sure how this is an advantage, because like I said, the U.S. has a gigantic rare earth metal mine that we just closed down because it wasn't profitable. Now that these are expensive and important, there's some companies that are trying to open these back up. I don't really know why it would be better to go mine these out in space, because it would certainly be cheaper to do it here on the Earth in proven reserves, and those proven reserves could last a long time. Even though China is dominating the market right now, I don't know really how strategic this is. The only advantages to a mining affirmative probably have to do with these other things, that mining in space might get us one of these other advantages. But as for its own advantage, the reason why it's kind of low on this is because it's kind of bad. Asteroids, there are a lot of them. They probably are coming for us. A recent study estimated that there are 940 near-Earth objects that are greater than 1 mile. These are not really a threat, but we've only detected about 85% of them. I'm not really sure how they calculate that we've only detected 85% of them. I'm pretty sure it has to do with like relativity and how gravity works, but we're pretty sure that there's some out there we don't know about. There are also thousands of smaller objects, and these smaller objects, you know, they are equivalent to a 10 megaton nuclear bomb, and they occur once about every 2,000 years, so they might be bad. And those small asteroids, there was one that exploded over Siberia in 1908. Some people think that was aliens. That's a discussion we'll get to in just a second, actually. And destroyed 2,000 square kilometers of forest. They can be pretty bad. It's the affirmative that's in your packet, detecting asteroids, because the great thing about asteroids is only one has to hit and we all die, so they're pretty good advantages. They're a sure destruction of the whole planet, which is always great to try and stop that. That's always a good thing. But they're pretty straightforward. We got to find them. Maybe we got to go destroy them. Those are the two different versions of the app. There was a policy paper NASA did about 3 years ago that discussed every possibility for destroying asteroids, where our current technology is, which technology would be best. That'll probably be the basis of any affirmative that goes out and tries to destroy them. One possible answer to that advantage is that even if we found them, we couldn't do anything about it, even in like the next 20 years. That NASA document is pretty sad. It basically says we're pretty doomed with technology. Colonization. It's simple. We destroyed this planet. We gotta move on. It's too late. We also might need to get off it because it's too late to try and save it from asteroids. Or it surprisingly might be more technically difficult to stop an asteroid than to get off the entire planet. Some people say we just need a hedge. Like, what if a pandemic comes around that we don't know is going to happen? It could kill everyone. So we need to hedge our bets. If we have a colony of people way away from here, humanity can never all die because there's a separate colony of humanity. It's probably pretty hard. Probably would take a really long time. But you could establish colonies like on the moon in the fairly short term, like 10 years or so. And they would maybe provide a reserve of people to repopulate the Earth should a pandemic wipe the rest of us out. All of the reasons for colonization are pretty sad. The environment, these advantages, a lot of them have to do with those climate mapping and satellite mapping and mapping of the different parts of the Earth and ocean mapping. There's some pretty good advantages here, but it's basically that we need to save the environment or stop global warming. Those things could destroy all of humanity. And better earth science can help us with all of those things. There's a myriad of different ways to have a better earth science. There's also And that's another way people might access the environment. People also might access the environment through as a subset of the education advantages and stuff like that. But there's lots of different ways to try to save the Earth from deforestation and global warming and stuff. There's even some literature that says if we just had better pictures of people destroying forests, people would stop doing it. So the like take pictures on the Amazon app might happen. International cooperation. This will be a pretty big part of the topic, I think. Just different advantages that we need to that certain kinds of space policies might lead us to work with China, the European Union, Russia, any of those countries I listed that have space programs: Japan, India, Iran, Israel. We could potentially cooperate with them over any of these things, and so maybe if whatever our space program is aligns with their interests, that would be a good thing. These might be disadvantages to affirmatives, too, on the flip side, that the affirmative does not cooperate internationally, and that makes people mad. And there's aliens. This is actually maybe a whole subset of things. Aliens, other bizarre physics things like E-waves or whatever that wipeout stuff is. Is that right, Ryan? E-waves?
There are a bunch of
them. Yeah. There's a whole bin of stupid, as I like to call it. I don't really even know what to say should be your approach to aliens. You should probably be packing a they don't exist pretty robust file. You should for sure have that as a key strategy. Other approaches, my partner Stephanie and I, our favorite way to approach the aliens debate was to just take it seriously, and we just had debates about aliens, whether grays were good or bad, and I don't know, Stephanie can tell you all about the different kinds of aliens, because she did the actual research, but we just actually engaged in it. It's pretty difficult, though, because there's like a lot of different people who write about aliens, and it's pretty difficult to keep up with. This is like a lot of literature, and a lot of nut basket literature. It's pretty hard to find. Like, you can't go on to journals and find this stuff. So, I don't know. I would just say aliens don't exist, but I don't know. It's going to be a hard world topic to keep up with. Okay. So, considerations for choosing your affirmatives. We've talked about those 12 things you should definitely have answers to, but considerations, which will maybe help make those 12 things a little bit clearer, is first, is there a reason the U.S. should do it, but not other countries? That's one of the first questions, because the counterplan to have another country do it, if it solves your affirmative, there's going to be some pretty good benefits to that, because then they don't have to have the U.S. spend money, and they don't have to have the U.S. expend political effort. It's a pretty easy way to win a debate, and will be a key counterplan on the topic. I think it might be the biggest counterplan on the topic, given the way it's going to lay out. The second consideration, is there a reason the U.S. should do it, but not private companies? This is another big part of the topic. This is going to be a huge counterplan. If your affirmative does not have built-in answers to these two questions, you will lose to counterplans a lot. A lot. So you have to think about this. If you like an app that doesn't answer these two questions, it's not a good affirmative. I don't care what you think, it's not a good affirmative. The final thing, which is a little bit less of a requirement, but I think it should be a strategic consideration. The easiest is the spending dissent. So can the affirmative overcome the spending dissent or the spending politics links, or does it have some trick for dealing with these? For instance, I asked one of my debaters at the end of our school year when we were doing work on this topic, what their plan was to deal with this part of the argument, and one potential way to deal with it, she was talking about a specific mining affirmative, and her argument was that she had done the cost and that we could net make money on the mining of a particular mineral that she wanted. So in net, the U.S. federal government made money from her affirmative. That's a pretty good trick if you're using one of those resource apps, because you might not link to this. And this will be a huge part of negative strategies. So that's a pretty good deal. my division. This is not, I don't think there's like broad agreement on this. And there are actually four types. Exploring and colonizing space from space. And all I mean that is that this technology is mostly space-based. Clearly it will be launched from the Earth, this category. You'll see, there's another category which is different in a little bit. But those are a certain kind of performance. They put stuff in space. And there are certain disads like the space debris disad and the ozone disad, which require you to send material through space to get a link to them, that will link to this category but not to some of the other categories. Helping or dominating things on the Earth. These are apps that will be focused on dominating the military here, getting rare earth metals back. Those have no intrinsic value to space exploration, but they do have intrinsic value to things on Earth. We already talked about that. I think you can see that. Exploring space from the Earth, which Ryan talked about last night, telescopes, SETI, stuff like that. We'll talk about what these specific apps are. But you lose a lot of disadvantage links to some cool disadvantage like the ozone and the space debris disadvantage because they don't send anything into space. They're a little bit different. Fourth category is international cooperation. These are apps that literally just cooperate with another country over whatever they want that are mostly based in their international advantages. So, exploring or colonizing space. Solar sails. This was read on the high school alternative energy topic, so I guarantee you people are going to read it on this topic, because I really like have no idea how it was run on that topic. But it's a form of space propulsion. The theory is that if you have a sail that can absorb the electromagnetic energy from the sun, you can kind of sail with it. It's kind of a little bit different than the way wind works, obviously, because there's no like atmosphere in space. But it's a way to explore. There are some people who say this will somehow solve global warming. I don't really get how that works. That's how it was on the alternative energy topic. This is like some really bad science. I don't think it's a great affirmative. But people will read it, and the reason I put it so high is because people have already read it on unrelated topics. So you need to have research about solar sails. But it's mostly an exploration app. There's a little bit of alternative energy aspect to it. Nuclear space propulsion. There was a thing called the Orion Project, which has been started and canceled a million times. That's where I would start with the U.S.'s nuclear space propulsion efforts. It's in the Orion Project. Most good scientists, again, say this is not helpful at all. A lot of people say that having a nuclear reactor would substantially benefit our space exploration. This, again, is just a way to explore space. There might be some people who say that this would be good for the U.S. nuclear industry and have some energy advantage based on that. The Constellation Program. This was NASA's proposal under President Bush for the future of NASA to replace the space shuttle program. It's a huge app because there's a lot of vested interest. Something like $2 billion was already spent on the program before it was canceled. There's a ton of people who have a self-interest in the program and lobbyists. So there's a ton of literature defending this program, saying that if we just finish Bush's Constellation program instead of canceled it, that would be great. It would get us everything we ever need in space. You can access any possible. All the future of space goes through Constellation. You can pretty much get any advantage from it. This is an app that we'll talk about a little bit. The University of Georgia has already put out this affirmative. I think this will be pretty popular because Constellation, that's a term of art, it refers to that specific program that Bush canceled. It's a pretty big affirmative that you should know about. Transorbital railroads and space elevators. These are a little bit different than each other. Transorbital railroads is a proposal by Robert Zubrin, president of the Mars Society, that would have NASA buy private sector launch vehicles and then sell the right to use those launch vehicles at artificially low prices. So how that works, that'd be essentially like if the U.S. built really chips and then just let people use them for free or really cheap. And the purpose of that is so that they could do cool stuff in space. And that maybe after we get them like kind of going and making money, they would kind of develop their own stuff in space and like get like a private space industry going. The reason that this is important is a lot of people say you can't accrue the benefits of space with only governments doing it. That until like profit seeking companies go up there and do it and the free market gets up there, we're not really gonna be able to explore space well until we have a robust private industry in space. A lot of America was colonized by corporate interests and different, some of the earliest stockholding companies and stuff like that. So there's some reason to go into this. Space elevators are a little bit different concept. Space elevator is where you put like a cable and you have a thing that can climb the cable and so it's a way to deliver stuff into space. So you have a satellite in space with a cable that goes all the way to the ground, and then there's a vehicle that can actually climb the cable. There was an X Prize for about $1 million to invent a good space elevator. That X Prize was captured by a company who demonstrated a pretty good space elevator, or potential maybe space elevator. And the reason that space is really expensive is because it's really expensive to launch stuff right now. A space elevator might exponentially decrease the cost of putting mass into space, which is one of the big entry barriers to any space program. It's really expensive to send payload or weight up into space. That's the primary limiting factor in space. It's expensive to send weight up there, and it's very difficult to do. So a successful space elevator, you can send whatever you want. You can send satellites up a lot more cheaply. It'd bring down the cost of satellites. You can send people up a lot more cheaply. And so you can do more exploration, scientific exploration in space. It'd be easier to build things. If we had a good, cheap way to put stuff in space, we could maybe assemble a rocket in space, which was part of the Constellation program's plan, was to build a launch vehicle, but then to also assemble a rocket up in space that was never assembled on the Earth, because you can, without gravity, you can like build a lot cooler stuff. And so space elevators would significantly help with that end. Asteroid detection, this is in your camp packet, you'll all be very familiar with this, so I won't belabor the point. We already talked about the main benefits are about what asteroids, you know, would impact the Earth. We already talked about that. The only other thing I'll say about this is that the NRC in 2008 estimated that ground-based astronomy